and all the hot water I wanted. My own private world. I didn't have to deal with anyone. I only went to a rehabilitation center so that I wouldn't have to return home so quickly. I started to get into a romance until someone asked me, "What do you have to offer him?" I didn't have much to offer at that time, and I knew it. I did learn about drug addiction and was given some tools. Again, I only went to the halfway house because I didn't want to go home and back to my old way of life. At the halfway house, I learned how to live clean and to use the tools of recovery. The main tool, the basis of my clean life. The thing that I remember about that meeting was so good that if he spoke to me, I'd melt. Later, I was told that it doesn't matter why you come in the beginning, just come. So I came. And I strutted, and I smiled, and I did what I could for a cookie, a compliment, a look, or a stroke. My ego needed anything it could get. At that time, I still didn't really know what being clean was all about, but I kept coming back. Eventually, I started coming for me. I realized that I'm a drug addict even if I did not take a great variety of drugs. I may not have done the things other drug fiends have done. I may not have gone as far down the road, but only because I didn't have the opportunity. I am a drug addict, not only because of the drugs, but because of the defects as well. Because of the lying, manipulating, conniving, self-loathing, and escaping, I qualified for this program. I also found that drugs were only a symptom of my disease. With meetings, help from the people in those meetings and my higher power, I started to grow. I got rid of the fear and the guilt. Anonymous. Why ME? Why not ME? My God, what am I doing here? Why am I in so much trouble? What am I going to do? Nothing had gone right for me in such a long time. Was I going crazy? Was there hope for me in this horrible existence that I called life? The only words that I could use to describe my life are fearful, desperate, aimless, and hopeless. As I thought of my past with remorse and disgust, I tried to think of anything that I had done or accomplished that was positive in any way. I had 3 beautiful children, a wife, 2 cars, a new house, and a good job. However, I could not think of a single thing in my life. I felt as though I was a complete failure, with nothing left to live for. For the past 14 years, I had been drinking heavily, and had experienced numerous consequences due to drinking, but I thought that was part of the game of being a responsible adult. I never liked responsibility and made a point to avoid it whenever possible. I was introduced to narcotics completely by accident. The accident was due to my drinking at 7 a.m. I suffered a broken neck in a head-on collision, and was taken to the hospital. I learned to enjoy the life, being waited on and having no responsibility. This was exactly what I had been looking for. Soap operas and narcotics. I recall the hospital staff telling me that I was an excellent patient. With all this encouragement, I devised many lies and cons to ensure a lengthy stay at their wonderful institution. Little did I know that I was setting a pattern of thinking that was to last many years. This pattern would be a very destructive force to my family and lifestyle. After being released from the hospital, I returned to alcohol. I thought I missed all the benefits of having a good time, so I went after all the gusto that I could handle. Gusto brought countless days and nights spent praying to the porcelain altar, smashed fingers in car doors and fights with my wife and family. All this, just to escape responsibility. As I continued to become more insecure with my actions and attitudes, I went even deeper into the bottle. I felt as though there was something horrible always ready to happen to me. 116. Why me? Why not me? 117. I was seemingly satisfied with my alcohol use, and only occasionally thought of drugs. I still thought about the wonderful treatment that I received at the hospital, and occasionally fantasized myself back there being a wonderful patient. For a period of 6 years, I had been unable to laugh and enjoy living. I was just a miserable human shell. My attitudes were negative, and I had started to suffer physically, acting out my fantasies, and looking for sympathy. Recalling the thought of my treatment in the hospitals, I was impelled to seek medical help for my ailments. I had developed stomach ulcers, due to what I thought was a bad diet and a very demanding job. I had begun to have problems with my knees, because I seemed to fall down a lot. After playing a good con on the doctor, I was finally hospitalized for tests. This was the beginning of the end. I had been able to convince the doctors that I was suffering from incurable and painful diseases. When I was released from the hospital, I was given prescriptions for various kinds of narcotics and downers to help me eliminate my suffering. I continued drinking alcohol while I took drugs. I became such an excellent patient that I was hospitalized 23 times in 4 years. During this time, I had surgery after surgery. I even had my stomach removed. All these surgeries ensured my drug supply. I was becoming a physical, mental, and spiritual mess. The constant conflict inside of me was more than I could deal with. With an ever-increasing amount of narcotics, I was able to function as a human being. I would even convince my children to watch their dad use a needle with his medicine, so that they would not hear the needle when it was their turn to get medicine. In the fall of 1979, I had an accident at work, where my hand was caught in a machine. As it happened, I looked at the machine operator and told him, "It's a good thing I'm on drugs, or I'd be very mad." Nothing that was happening to me made any difference, as long as I was taking my medicine. I had no idea that I might have a problem with drugs. Many times, I thought that I might be taking too many, but I never thought I would have any problem quitting whenever the pain was gone. I was getting drugs from the drugstore and writing my own scripts at an alarming rate. It was quite a job to record and keep track of all the drugstores I'd used every day. There were times when I'd wish that I would get caught, so I could end the existence I was experiencing. 3 days after my discharge from the hospital for my accident at work, my wish came true. In desperation, I tried to pass a bad script that I had written with my hand in a cast. I can't describe the fear that I felt when the druggist made her phone call. Before I knew what was happening, I was in serious trouble. 118 Narcotics Anonymous. I considered running, suicide, insanity, anything to help me get out of this jam. I recall the thoughts that I had as I was talking to the police. They were the same thoughts that I had many times. Perhaps I could act very innocent and naive. After all, this was my first offense. I made a plea to see my doctor. The police could see that I was terrified, and hurting as any drug addict hurts when he can't get drugs. I was told to see the doctor and get help. I instantly thought that I could get over on the law if they saw that I was serious about getting help. Through the doctor and other friends, I was sent to a drug rehabilitation center back in my home state. This was going to be my ticket out of trouble. I just had to comply with their program, and that's all the law would need to drop charges against me. I went to rehab, knowing that I took too many drugs. While I was doing my time, I was asked questions like, "Do you think you're an addict? Do you think you may have a problem with alcohol? How do you deal with anger?" I answered these questions with, "Possibly, no, I've never been angry a day in my life." I knew that I was in trouble when they diagnosed me as a pathological liar. I had many problems facing me when I got out of rehab. The law didn't go away and my wife was very bitter about my activities. My job was on the line because of my inability to function at work, and I didn't have very much money to pay my bills. Many things were happening to me, and I didn't know what to do. The rehabilitation center gave me some tools and knowledge about my drug addiction. I then needed tools to cope with the things that were happening in my life. One of the things that I was told to do in the rehabilitation center was to go to NA meetings, 90 meetings in 90 days. I didn't know what to expect, but I would try them anyway. What did I have to lose? The court also gave me their version of an aftercare plan. It was to attend a meeting every day for 365 days. It was easy to comply with their plan. If I didn't comply, I would go to jail for 7 to 10 years. I was resigned to the fact that I was going to be going to meetings for a while, so I thought I may as well make the best of them. I did the things that were suggested. Now I was going to be clean and serene. Wrong. Thank God I stayed clean, but in the last 2 years, my serenity has been interrupted on many occasions. After 1 year clean, my wife just couldn't understand why I was still going to meetings every day, leaving her and the children alone so much. Why me? Why not me? 119. When I told her that I planned to attend meetings of Narcotics Anonymous, even after my sentence was fulfilled, she just went absolutely off-center, making sure that I knew she didn't like that at all. I had picked a sponsor by now, and I was constantly crying to him with my problems. He told me to say the Serenity Prayer. I couldn't believe that he would tell me something so idiotic. How could that help my situation? I was being very negative in all situations in my life. I was told to work the 12 steps of recovery of NA. One thing I had to do was to come to believe that a power greater than myself could restore me to sanity. I had known all along that I was powerless over my addiction, and that my life was unmanageable, but I just didn't have the faith that I needed to be restored. The next few months were very tough for me. I got divorced. When I was able to look at the entire scope of my relationship with my wife, I found that we were married for all of the wrong reasons. I had never known what true love or true caring was all about. I was totally selfish in all of my relationships. I was hurt. My ego had been crushed. I was humiliated. I have come to believe that humiliation is nothing more than being humbled against my own will. With this major trauma in my life, I found a power greater than myself. I found, through the fellowship of NA, that I could either be very miserable with my situation or I could accept it and carry on. All these words still didn't stop the hurt. What finally stopped the hurt and pain that I was feeling was the suggestion that I get active in the fellowship of NA. I started service work with picking up ashtrays. Now I am able to serve the people who saved my life in various ways. One thing that was given to me from the beginning was the phrase, "Keep coming back, it works." Thank God for NA. Since that time, I have tried to be a little more caring and loving when I deal with people. The first relationship I had with another addict made me see even more how much of my pride, ego, self-centeredness, and lack of faith I still have. The program of NA is a new way of life for me, and it is taking me a long time to learn how to live. You see, I'm as close to death as the person coming off the street, after one day clean. All I have to do is take any form of drug and I'm...